Let's be honest, the New Orleans Pelicans are a mess. And as a basketball fan, like many of you, they're one of my biggest disappointments of the season thus far. But before we tap into those problems and what's making them be this big mess, I want to explain to you guys how my basketball mind works and how my mind works for a lot of different things outside of basketball. So most people, they look at situations and they look at things and they just leave it at what it is, which I can respect. To a certain degree, some things are better to be read or looked at and you just leave it alone. But for me, I'm always a person, and it's probably why I'm in the position that I'm in today as far as what I do for a living in my career. I'm a person that when I see something, I want to analyze it. You know what I mean? And like I said, not everything needs to be analyzed, not everything needs to be looked at. But for the most part, when I see something that is a mess or a disaster or something going wrong, I kind of sit back and want to know why or how it got to where it's at. And for me, the Pelicans are like that. That's what's so interesting about them is, for me as a basketball fan and also a person that works in the basketball media, whatever you want to call it, they are a team that going into the season I had some hope for. I didn't think that they were going to be a contender. I didn't think that they were going to play for anything significant, but I thought that they could be a lot better than what they've shown thus far. Now, I will say, as much hope and expectations that I did have for them, I was a little skeptical about some of the things that they did this past offseason. Now, luckily for me, what I do for a living allows me to document some of the things that I say along this journey of NBA season that we are approaching. So, for starters, I was a big critic and maybe going after Stan Van Gundy and just going after him. And then I was even a bigger critic and actually going out and hiring him. And the reason being is because I think when you have a team like the Pelicans, a lot of their potential is because they have a lot of young players. They have a lot of interesting and exciting young talent. When you talk about Brandon Ingram, Zion Williamson, those guys are already, as young as they are, they're kind of solidifying their steps in the NBA. Now, how far they're going to take their steps or how high their plateau will reach, nobody knows. But they're cementing themselves as, you know, cornerstone young pieces that you want to build around. Now, the rest of them, when we talk about the Lonzo Balls, Nikhil Alexander, Josh Hart, Jackson Hayes, you know, we're still figuring out exactly what you want to do with that or who they're going to be as or what they're going to be as NBA players. But when you have, we just named, what, about five or six players. When you have five or six young players that we really can look at and say, man, they have potential. You think you want to go get somebody who's going to lead that group and also be relatable to those people. And I think that's an underrated part of coaching and coaching success and then coaching failures in the NBA is who's leading the group. You know, if you have a veteran team, you probably want to go out and get a veteran coach. You probably wouldn't be so smart to go get a brand new coach who's never had the experience of leading a group of guys. And if you are going to go get somebody that's quote unquote new in the coaching world, you maybe want to go get somebody who's shown that they can lead a group of NBA players. Like, for example, the Brooklyn Nets. They're a team that's kind of ready to win. Not even kind of, I'm sorry. They're a team that's been assembled to be ready to win this year. They bring in a new coach who is a rookie as far as coaching, but Steve Nash does have a history of being able to lead guys because he's one of the best point guards to ever play our game, two-time MVP, and had tremendous success leading guys in the NBA, so there's hope for him. Just like Steve Kerr. Steve Kerr was a new coach when he got hired to the Warriors, but he had experience of being around championship teams and just being around teams in general, even with his role as a GM for the Phoenix Suns. And we know being around Phil Jackson, you know, Michael Jordan, Greg Popovich in San Antonio, he has a basketball history, even playing for Lou Olsen at Arizona University. So he comes from a good background. So that's a different type of rookie versus just, you know, a guy who was just being an assistant coach and jumping into the chair for a team. It's a little bit different. There are some variables that can make things, you know, kind of fit the narrative or fit where we're trying to go. Context is best for everything, not to lead astray. But I think that's an important thing, you know, having a head coach who's going to be able to relate, understand, and communicate to his players is one of the most instrumental things as far as failure and success in the NBA. And I think the Pelicans put themselves at a disadvantage by hiring Stan Van Gundy. It's nothing against Stan Van Gundy. He has had success in the NBA, so I can't take that away from him. With the Orlando Magic and Dwight Howard, that was a very successful team that came short in the NBA Finals to one of the best players we've ever seen, and a great Los Angeles Lakers team with Kobe Bryant, Lamar Odom, Paul Gasol, and Phil Jackson, who's probably one of the top coaches to ever coach. So that's no, you know, L for Stan Van Gundy. They made it to the Finals. And they lost to some guys who are Hall of Famers and some of the best to ever do it. But after that, his most recent memory as far as a head coach that we can think of was the Detroit Pistons, which was an absolute mess. And one of the things about that I remember that kind of stuck out to me and made me not so eager to see Stan Van Gundy be the Pelicans coach is he was kind of out of the loop. You know what I mean? He kind of was behind the eight ball. He kind of was slow to see what was becoming in the NBA. When you think about his front court of Josh Smith, Greg Monroe, and Andre Drummond, it kind of told you that he was catching on to what the game was pushing to a little late. A lot of other people and a lot of other teams and coaches were able to see what was coming as far as versatile big man shooting, and he kind of got behind the eight ball a little bit there, and he caught on a little late. And he was so late that he kind of got desperate. Because if you don't remember, Stan Van Gundy was not also the head coach of the Pistons, but he also had kind of some control in the front office. He had some GM responsibilities to allow him to have and rotate players and get exactly what he wanted to have to be a successful team. So what led to that was him kind of panicking and going out and giving contracts to like John Lure. And I can't remember John Lure's contract off the top of my head, but if you don't remember, John Lure was a floor spacing big, so to speak, in his time, and he got paid a hefty bag. Langston Galloway got paid a hefty bag. They went out and they spent some ridiculous amount of dollars on guys because they were shooters, but they kind of overpaid for them because they were in a panicky mood. They were so behind that they felt they had to play catch up that they threw bags out to guys who, I never want to say a player is undeserving, but it was kind of like, yeah, you really gave John Lure, he's making $11 million a year or 15. John Lure is making some crazy amount of money. Y'all can look that up, but they just got done paying some of those contracts off like literally a year or two ago, if I'm not mistaken. They were paying Josh Smith for a very long time, to be exact. But that right there showed me that he may have not been in tune with what's going on with the game. That was a bad, bad, bad last memory of Stan Van Gundy as far as coach. What he did with Detroit, it was a mess. It was a big mess, and they kind of made some ground up for it at the end of his run because they went and got Blake Griffin, and it was okay, but it was still never enough to make up for what had happened in the years prior. So with that being my last memory of Stan Van Gundy, it kind of turned me off, and it made me want the Pelicans to stay away from that. I felt that they could have used a young coach, not even young as far as age, but young and as far as when he was brought into the coaching world, so to speak. So, you know, maybe a young, fresh coach, somebody that's newer. You know, I would have liked to have seen a David Blatt. You know, David Blatt has been talked about as a genius as far as his offensive game. I wouldn't even mind D'Antoni. You know what I mean? D'Antoni has had some interesting runs, but D'Antoni puts teams together. He makes them competitive. And they're always this far away. But with this team, you have a bunch of young talented players, so you're not looking to win championships anyway. You're just looking to put this talent together on the floor, allow them to develop to one day, boom, be ready to compete. And if D'Antoni isn't cutting it then, at least he was there to get those players developed, give them some confidence, and boom, you replace him with somebody who's now ready to lead this team to a championship, which is kind of what we saw in Golden State. As much as we hate it, I know people like me, I don't like what they did because I think Mark Jackson deserved better and deserved a little bit more because he is the guy that kind of put everything together there. But a lot of people say he just wasn't the guy to lead them to a championship. He got them everything that they needed and got them where they needed to be to compete for it. And Steve Kerr was the guy to come in and seal the deal. And I was thinking maybe D'Antoni could be something like that for the Pelicans. D'Antoni is known to you know, inflate stats and give guys different roles and give guys this confidence and kind of make them, you know, reach a peak that they maybe weren't seen to reach. So, like, for example, Jeremy Lin, we know Lin Sanity. As much potential as you may have saw in Jeremy Lin before the Lin Sanity thing, if you saw any potential at all, you never thought that Jeremy Lin would be as good as he was there. Even if you talk about Steve Nash, all the potential Steve Nash had when he was with the Dallas Mavericks, I don't think anybody ever saw him being a two-time MVP. You look at Amari Stoudemire and how well he was. You look at James Harden. Like, James Harden has always had talent, but being with D'Antoni has made him a guy that was in a conversation for MVP year in and year out, and is now going down in history as probably one of the greatest scorers we've ever had. So D'Antoni has a history of that, and I think for a young Pelican team, he could have did that, inflated some stats. Yes, it probably wouldn't have been the best defensive team, but you would have had Brandon Ingram confident. You would have Zion confident. You would have Lonzo Ball confident. They would have been playing a brand of basketball that they all probably would have believed in, because it would allow them all to score, share the basketball, get up and down. And what young NBA players don't like that? Who doesn't like emphasizing offense, putting up great numbers, getting up and down, playing fast, and winning a few games more than you just did the couple years previous? Every young player loves that. And like I said, when it gets to the point where they're now at that level where they need to be contending, and Mike D'Antoni isn't cutting it, you replace him with a head coach that's going to get you there, if suitable. But I think that's much more better than what they're at now. So now, not to keep going all over the place, now when you have that, it seems like the opposite is going on with Van Gundy. First and foremost, when we start diving into the Pelicans now specifically, the pace, right? I just talked about D'Antoni and getting up and down and how young players love that and they love their numbers and all of that. They're still trying to hit certain goals and personal goals in their careers, like all-star games, like, you know, end of the season awards, most improved player, all NBA first team, rookie team. Players, they want to hit those goals. They have milestones that they want to reach as individuals. And with how Stan Van Gundy is doing it, it's going to be hard for a lot of them to reach some of those milestones. Because number one, pace. They went from being like a top five pace. I want to say last time I looked, they were tied for second in the NBA as far as pace with the Houston Rockets, right below the Milwaukee Bucks. And when I looked at this year, they were a bottom five team, ranked around like tied for 27th. In pace, which is a significant drop off. To be tied for second and then now all the way down at 27 or 28 is atrocious. And I think part of that is not just Stan Van Gundy, but it's also David Griffin and the roster construction that he has put together around all of these young, exciting players that have so much potential. It's a bit of a head-scratching thing. I get a little bit why they bring in Steven Adams, you know, veteran leadership. He's a good locker room guy. He's going to give you some toughness as far as interior defense. Again, he's not going to win a defensive player of the year or anything like that, but he makes you respectable on paper as far as protecting the basket and rim protection, because you probably don't want to log in minutes for Zion at the five position. I get it. And Jackson Hayes is still ways and ways and ways away from being that guy, if he's ever going to be that guy. So I get bringing him in, but before they even allow him to touch the floor, they extend him. They extend Steven Adams before they even see how it's going to work. And when you get him, even though you know he makes you somewhat respectable on paper defensively as far as protecting the rim and having a back line of defense and communication and all those different things that you need when you're coaching and putting together a young team, he does give you that on paper. Notice that I'm hinting on paper, because in reality, they're 5-10 and the defense isn't exactly what you would hope it would be if you're going to give up everything that you have to give up offensively by acquiring Steven Adams, which we'll get to. I don't want to jump everywhere and confuse you guys or lose y'all anywhere. But I get that. But I don't get extending him before you can actually see him gel with everybody on the floor. Then you trade Jrue Holiday, which I get it. It was a good trade as far as the returns on picks. But then also in that trade, you get Eric Bledsoe, which doesn't make much sense because you already have a young point guard and Lonzo Ball, who was the second overall pick, who is a guy that's dealing with confidence issues and consistency and different things like that, which isn't all the Pelicans' fault. Lonzo has his flaws within himself that he needs to work on for sure. But you're not going to help his flaws by bringing in an already starting caliber point guard in Eric Bledsoe. You know what also is not going to help Lonzo's confidence? Drafting a young point guard in Kyra Lewis out of Alabama with the 13th overall pick. So now automatically when you make these moves, those are three significant moves that you make that indicate to me if I'm Lonzo Ball or if I'm a teammate of Lonzo Ball or if I'm a manager of Lonzo Ball or if I'm the father, LaVar Ball, of Lonzo Ball, that you kind of really don't value him. You kind of don't value him. Number one, you bring in a coach who's openly, publicly spoke about how he would play Lonzo Ball. And he said he would basically turn him into a 3-and-D type of player, which is exactly what he's done, which is mind-blowing to me because that's far from what you need to do with Lonzo if you want him to reach his fullest potential, which is what I thought the Pelicans would want to do by trading away Anthony Davis and wanting Lonzo Ball as a big part of that package. You're getting Lonzo Ball and Ingram and then some other stuff. But those are the two that you really want in that package, because if those two guys hit their fullest potential with a Zion in the mix, it could be something scary. So that was the first thing. I understand Van Gundy, after we already publicly heard what he thought of Lonzo and how he would use Lonzo. Then you draft a young point guard with a 13th overall pick, which is a nice pick to have if you're as good as the Pelicans on paper. Then you also bring in Eric Bledsoe after getting rid of Jrue Holiday, which after drafting a young point guard, you go out and get an older, experienced, solidified starting point guard, which is like, man, why are you getting all these point guards if you have me? And then last but not least, you bring in Steven Adams, who isn't a floor spacer, when Lonzo Ball already is making strides with his jump shot, but still very far away from being a knockdown shooter. So those are four things for me that turns you away from Lonzo. Or if I'm Lonzo, or if I'm anybody around Lonzo, it makes me look at the situation and say, man, they kind of don't value him. Or they kind of don't know what they want to do with him. And if I'm a guy like Lonzo who's already dealing with, like I said, consistency and confidence, it may weaken my confidence even more, which didn't surprise me when both sides didn't agree on an extension. You know what I mean? Lonzo Ball will enter restricted free agency this offseason because both sides couldn't agree. And I think that was a good decision for Lonzo because all of their actions are saying that they really don't have a plan for him. Now, aside from the Lonzo Ball situation, the reason Steven Adams' situation kind of is a domino effect and affects a lot of different things is because the number one thing I mentioned with Lonzo is the spacing. The spacing doesn't just hurt Lonzo, it hurts everybody. Because when you look at their best players, or you look at their starting five, or guys who are going to play significant minutes, none of them are legitimate knockdown shooters. And the knockdown shooter they have, J.J. Redick, he's openly admitting that, you know, he's shooting the worst he's ever shot because of the way the season is. He can't really get a rhythm. You know what I mean? It's hard to get a rhythm in the league today because of the pandemic and the virus and how they have to handle it. You got three games here, then you miss two games because of protocol. You can't go into the practice facility as much as you want to. You know what I mean? It's just so much going on that it is hard for shooters to really find their rhythm. He spoke about this on his podcast. And that was really the only knockdown shooter or quote-unquote respectable shooter that they have. Brandon Ingram, I would say Brandon Ingram is respectable as a shooter, but everybody else is kind of iffy. I mean, Alonzo has his days. He's shooting very bad as of now. I think it's the way that he started the year percentage-wise. He's picked it up as of late, but he's never going to be a guy that's going to be feared by defenses. Eric Bledsoe, as far as a perimeter shooter, is never going to be feared by defenses. Zion rarely takes him, and he's never going to be feared by defenses. And if you're putting out a lineup of Eric Bledsoe, Lonzo Ball, Brandon Ingram, Zion Williamson, and Steven Adams, where's the perimeter shooting threat? Where is the guy on the floor that the defenses feel threatened by and feel like they can't leave? So now when you're running the offense through Brandon Ingram and he's doing the pick and roll action, there's no avenues for him to go to because who is the defense sticking on that they don't want to leave? Who is the guy that the defense says, oh, I can't leave him, so boom, Brandon Ingram has it. There is none. So now Brandon Ingram is going, and there's no avenues for him to drive. He's kicking it out to guys, and they're not making the shots. And it's just bad. And then they're playing slow, like I said, so there's a lot less easy baskets when you have a slower pace. You know, and that's the name of the game, is to get as many easy baskets as you can. Every great scorer, if you look at how they score, they get a lot of easy ones, and those add up. Free throw line, layups, transition, and then in a half court spot, once you racked up 18 points off free throws and layups, you only need about 8 points in a half court spot, and you 26-point game score. You know, look at the Zach LaVines getting out on a break for dunking and attacking and getting to the free throw line. Look at the great scores. Look at Harden. Look how many free throw attempts he gets. Look how many layups he gets. It's easy baskets and free throws. And then once you add up your points there and rack them up there, you don't really have to do too much in a half court, because it's way more tougher to score in a half court setting for anybody. I don't care who you are. It's much more easier scoring in transition when everybody's not set and everybody's scrambling, trying to recover, trying to get back on defense. It's way easier to score there in the free throw line than when it's a set defense looking at you. Everybody's there. I don't care who you are. It's always going to be easier scoring in transition than half court defense. And that's really my main thing, is the Steven Adams thing is a domino effect that I just don't get, especially because they extended him now. Because you sacrifice pace and spacing by getting him, and you're supposed to sacrifice that for better defense, and the defense is a bottom feeding defense. Last time I checked, they have a bottom five defense. Defense isn't guarding anybody. People are just lighting them up. They're not shooting threes. They can't really score. They lost to the Minnesota Timberwolves, who didn't have D'Angelo Russell or Karl Anthony Towns, because they're not good. And I think it all starts with adding Steven Adams. You're playing Lonzo Ball in a way that's not going to allow him to reach his fullest potential. And if Lonzo Ball isn't reaching his fullest potential, there's no reason to really have him. He doesn't, you know what I mean? He has to play in a certain way that you're going to get the fullest value out of him. Because if not, if you're playing Lonzo Ball as a 3-and-D wing, he's just defense. You know what I mean? He hasn't shown us that we can count on him from the three-point line consistently to label him a 3-and-D wing. And he's so young, why would you want to take away his best trait, which is passing and getting up and down and making others better and making, you know, passing the ball is something that's contagious. And once you have a guy that's so willing to give it up, everybody becomes willing to give it up, and it's movement and it's pace. But if you're not doing that, then it's taking the ball out of his hands. And, you know, now we just got Brandon Ingram trying to shoot himself into games over four defenders. And we're looking at Brandon Ingram and some of his performances, and we're like, that was a tough game for him. And now it makes sense. There's nowhere for him to really go. Because if I'm playing the Pelicans, all I'm saying is all eyes on Brandon Ingram, and we're going to allow these other guys to hit us from behind the arc. And if they have a game where they're knocking it down, so be it. They'll have to beat us. Lonzo Ball is going to have to knock down threes. Eric Bledsoe is going to have to knock down threes. You know what I mean? For us to lose this game. But we'll live with that. A lot of teams are going to live with Lonzo Ball and Eric Bledsoe and whoever beating them from behind the arc before they allow Brandon Ingram to go off for 40 and beat them. And it's going to be tough. It's going to be tough for Brandon Ingram. I've seen the frustrations from everybody. You know, I'm seeing dips in numbers. Brandon Ingram is kind of putting around the same numbers, but some of the points are dropping a little bit. The assists, I think, are going up a tad. Lonzo's assists have completely dropped off. I think he was like a 7 or 8 assist type guy. He's all the way at 4 because he's having the ball taken out of his hands by Bledsoe. And then you draft Kyra Lewis at 13, and he barely kind of gets minutes. And that could have been another pick for another significant guy like an Aaron Naismith, who isn't doing anything spectacular in Boston. But again, he's in a situation that isn't the best for him right now. But I think he could have benefited playing in New Orleans a lot better than Boston, because New Orleans would have needed him to shoot the ball and give him opportunity from day one. But the Pelicans are a problem. They are a mess. Let's just be honest. I'm your boy, Pee-wee the Plug. As always, welcome to my channel. If you are new, leave a like, leave a subscription, leave a comment. Let me know your feedback on this video. This is something I'm going to be doing new. Something called Let's Be Honest, but we're just going to be honest about a lot of different topics. But as always, I'm out.